your expectations of God and who God is and what he does are faulty, then when things are tough, you won't recognize or accept that he's present, because the circumstances will not match up to your expectations about God. And your expectations about God need to be true. They need to be scriptural.
The glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life, an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Great things he hath done. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him things he has done. Let's stand for the last verse. Let's stand. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done. And all God's people said, and those who were really thrilled and excited said, I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. Beautiful words. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you.
There is none like you.
There is none like you. If you believe that, sing it out. There is none like you. Come on, church, this morning. There is none like you. There is none like you.
Can't be a more amazing place to sit and think about the Lord Jesus and commune with Jesus than on the shores of the Lake of Galilee. And I think this has to be my favorite place here in Israel. We love it here. I actually first came here 25 years ago, and I told the folks who met for dinner in Toronto before we came here that we had two little girls at that point, and we came to the Lake of Galilee, and Hannah was about 4 or 5, and she was so excited, and she went rushing off ahead of us, and she rushed towards the water, and then she turned around and she got her feet all wet, and she came running back again, and she looked so crestfallen. And I said to her, "What's the matter, Hannah?" And she said, "I thought I'd be able to walk on the water." So disappointing. Anyway, I said, good for you for trying, Hannah, and we went and had a good paddle together. But you know, some of you might have felt that kind of disappointment as you've come here. You might not have acknowledged that it was disappointment, but it might not be quite as you were expecting it to be. And when we were at the Garden Tomb on the first day, I gave you an invitation from Jesus, and it was, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Come, take, learn, find. And maybe you've been too busy to do that so far, and maybe you are even wearier than you were when you heard that invitation, "Come to me, all you who are weary." But I want to read another invitation to you this morning from Jesus, and I think this has to be the most beautiful. This is Mark chapter 6, verse 31, where Jesus says, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." What an invitation. Jesus was so often surrounded by vast crowds of people, and actually not so far from here, he fed a vast crowd of people, and you went there yesterday to the Mount of Beatitudes. And he had them, it tells us in Scripture, sit down on the green grass, and then he fed them. Jesus lets us sit down on the green grass, and then he feeds us. There's something very significant about that little sentence. There isn't a lot of green grass in Israel, if you hadn't noticed. But wherever Jesus gets you to sit down, there is green grass, because it's lush, and he's going to have you sit in the place where he will restore your soul and feed you. And he had them sit down on the green grass. He fed them the loaves and the fishes, and there was plenty left over. And Jesus has brought us here to sit down on the green grass so that he can feed us, each of us individually. And he will do that for us. I'm not sure what you were expecting when you came here. And maybe you didn't realize you had expectations until your expectations were disappointed. Probably first at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. That is such a strange place to visit. Maybe then in Bethlehem. Maybe you were disappointed. Maybe you never made it to the star on the floor, whatever the star on the floor represents. And then maybe you were overwhelmed when you went to the Garden of Gethsemane and looked at those trees and wondered if one of those trees was where Jesus actually knelt and wept and struggled with God. So I don't know where your expectations are anymore here in Israel, and I don't know if you're going home more convinced about who Jesus is, or more confused about who Jesus is, or longing to be just closer to Jesus, and you came here thinking that was going to happen, and maybe it hasn't happened yet. Maybe you'll be going home with a real relationship with Jesus for the first time in your life, maybe a deeper relationship than you've ever had before. Maybe you're older in years. You've longed to come on this trip, and in your life, God has saved the best till last, and he's turned your watery life into wine, even while you've been here. It's wonderful how God very often does save the best till last. even into our older years. And maybe you've had answers to questions that you've had for years, and maybe now you're intellectually satisfied. Perhaps you're intellectually much more curious. And you might be going home defeated and dejected because this is very interesting and it's fun, but it's a little disconnected from the life you live at home. And the life you live at home is the life that's caused you to come here, perhaps with a broken heart, with sadness, with grief. I know some of you are in grief, with confusion, with disappointment, with discouragement deep in your soul. And you've seen many wonderful sights, but if you had to be honest, you haven't seen Jesus. You just haven't seen Jesus. And he is still a stranger to you. And if you were putting a title to this talk I'm giving to you, it would be No Longer a Stranger. No longer a stranger. If you are brokenhearted and a little despondent, you're not the first. You're not the first to be heading home longing for a believing heart and maybe wondering if this Jesus thing is all actually a bit of an illusion. Many of us, I didn't have a Jesus in my childhood. I didn't grow up in a Christian home. My parents divorced when I was 19 and I came to know Christ in the midst of all that brokenheartedness. But maybe some of you had a childhood Jesus and he's just not enough anymore. He's not enough for what's going on in your life and all the things that have happened, the challenges that you've faced as an adult. I wonder who told you who Jesus is. And I wonder if the Jesus you learnt about as a child is enough for you. I want you to let Jesus tell you who Jesus is. If he never has done before in this place over these 2 days, we're going to read an extraordinary account of two despondent people who were heading home with discouragement in their hearts. You have it in your folders. It's Luke chapter 24. I'm going to read to you from verse 13. On the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel, and what is more, it's the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and slow to believe all the things that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" This is a phenomenal passage. In this passage, we meet these two disciples. They've waited for Jesus. They've known Jesus really well. They thought they knew Jesus as a prophet, powerful in word and deed, the amazing Messiah. They had loved him. He had loved them. He had called them his friends. They'd witnessed miracles beyond their wildest imaginings. They'd seen people healed. They'd seen dead people raised. They'd seen blind people given their sight. They'd seen loaves and fishes multiplied. And now it was all over. As far as they were concerned, Jesus was dead. The powerful one was in the end powerless, it would seem. I wonder if it seems to you that Jesus is powerless and that somehow Jesus is not alive in your life. And along with the death of Jesus was the death of all their dreams, all the things that they thought were going to happen, all they, verse 21, had hoped for, had not worked out as they expected. And I wonder if you came to Israel with your had hoped for tucked away in your heart, whatever it is that you've been longing for, regarding your children, your husband, your wife, your desire for a husband or maybe a wife, your career, your home. There's something you always had hoped for, and it still hasn't come to be. So we find ourselves eavesdropping on this conversation between Jesus and these two disciples. We're told they have, verse 25, blind hearts, slow to believe. Verse 27, they have broken hearts, their faces are downcast. Within a few verses and several hours, these blind, broken hearts become burning hearts, verse 32, believing hearts, verse 35, proclaiming how Jesus was recognized by them. And in verse 50, they become blessed hearts. So what brings about the change in a person from a blind, broken heart to a burning, believing heart? How is it that Jesus moves in an individual's life from being a stranger to being a friend for life, for eternal life? I've come that you might have life and life abundant. I want to go on this journey with these two disciples and discover the condition of their hearts and the challenge to their hearts and this change in their hearts. The encounter on the road to Emmaus and the meetings that took place subsequently in their little house and then in the house of the other disciples were, of course, pre-Pentecost. The Holy Spirit had not yet been given. We live post-Pentecost. We live the other side of the giving of the Holy Spirit. But this journey that they went on is still open to us. This is a journey from Jesus being a stranger to being a friend, from ignorance of who Jesus is to understanding of who Jesus is, from information in the scriptures leaving us blind to transformation in the soul, leaving our hearts burning, from words on a page to words of life, from sadness to joy, from thinking it's all over in our lives, all we had hoped for, to realizing it's actually only just beginning. From loneliness to belonging, from darkness to daybreak. It's a remarkable journey. We've talked about the physical and the spiritual in your time in Israel. We see the physical. We see two men walking along a road, possibly a man and a woman walking along the road with Jesus. It's a physical journey, but it becomes this extraordinary spiritual journey. And they do not have the Holy Spirit at this point, and we do. We are post-resurrection, post-Pentecost. Yet are we? Do we really live in the good of the amazing truth that Jesus Christ is alive? What difference has it made to you today that Jesus is alive? And by his indwelling spirit, he lives in me. You see, when Jesus dwells within us by his spirit, we know that he's true to his promises. And one of his promises is, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. These disciples felt forsaken, and sometimes we feel forsaken. The theory is wonderful, but in practice we doubt and we despair and we grieve, and Jesus becomes a stranger to us. He's no longer a friend to us. He seems distant to us, and we find ourselves heading home to all that's familiar with our faces downcast. Richard Tao says, "It isn't the presence of Jesus that turns our world around and brings hope and peace instead of despair and fear. It is our awareness of his presence." It's not just Jesus being alive and saying that. It's knowing that in our own lives. And in these 2 days of stillness and quiet, it's our prayer that Jesus, who has journeyed with us on this journey, whether you know that or not, will reveal himself to us in new ways. And he will change broken hearts and blind hearts into burning hearts. So how does he do it? Well, if you put in headings, some people love to put headings. Heading number one, blind hearts. What is it that causes their hearts to be blind? Verse 13. That same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened, and as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. In other words, they were blind. So who were they, and where were they going? Well, presumably, they were going home. They were going away from the place of promise, Jerusalem, where all their dreams seemed to have died. And they're stranded on this lonely country road home. And our guide pointed out this road down to the right, he said the other day, that's the road to Emmaus. Oh, I would love to walk that road. It's a physical road and it's a spiritual road. It's a road between Jerusalem, the city of the presence of God for these disciples, back to Emmaus, this obscure little place, despised place, where nothing exciting ever happened. So they're stranded between the death they've just witnessed and the life that they had hoped for that they no longer believe is possible. The new story, which was so exciting, to going back to this old familiar story of home. They're stranded between hope of everything that was in Jerusalem to despair of life just being as it always was, which means Jesus wouldn't be in it. And maybe you feel stranded in that same place. They had dreamed beyond the confines of this small, obscure little village that they lived in. But their dream seems to have come to nothing, and maybe you did. Maybe you dreamed beyond. And then when it got really tough, it's as though Jesus isn't there anymore. These disciples had dreamed beyond. One day, disciples walked on this shore. They weren't disciples at all, they were fishermen. And Jesus said, "Follow me. Out of your boat and your nets and all the nets that tie you down, follow me." And they dreamed beyond, and they did. They followed him. And maybe you have never really stepped into the adventure of following Christ. Maybe you're too busy tending your nets, getting your boat out, feeding your family. And you haven't got caught up in the adventure. But these two had. They had become disciples. They had an exciting life ahead of them. It was very hard to go back to Emmaus to be nobodies with no life ahead of them, just the same old, same old. So why are they on this road? Well, they're trying to get away from and at the same time make sense of all the confusion that lies behind them, everything that's happened in Jerusalem. They're trying to put a distance between themselves and their pain, but as you will have discovered, whenever you do that, you take your pain with you. It's easy to go on holiday and think, when I get on that holiday and lie on that beach, it'll all be good. No, it won't. You take your troubles in your old kit bag. You take your burdens in your suitcase. You never run away from them. So they can't distance themselves from their pain. They're actually still weighed down by it. So what they're talking about is their pain. It's their pain and confusion. Jesus comes alongside them because they are going round and round in circles. Verse 14, talking with each other. They're using human logic. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, verse 15. With each other, round and round, back and forwards. They don't read any conclusion. They don't open the scriptures. They don't open the scriptures and therefore they forget what has been promised. They forget to remember what Jesus said. And when we're in pain, we forget to remember what Jesus has promised us. And they do the same thing. And so they find everything very confusing. I wonder where you've gone with your confusion on this trip. I wonder if you've gone to your friend or your husband or your wife, or whether you've actually gone to God. I said, "God, this place doesn't make sense to me. This is what I was expecting and this is what I see." Or, "Wow, God, this is what I see." Have you actually talked to God yet since you've been in Israel? Have you brought your confusion and your pain to him, or are you just kind of going round and around in circles? I love how Jesus steps into the middle of the muddle. Jesus is the expert at stepping into the middle of the muddle in their lives. So why don't they recognize him? Well, heading number two, because they have broken hearts. Verse 17, he asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. When your own situation and your personal circumstances, as they call it, everything that had happened, that's their circumstances, is not looked at in the context of truth and the big picture, then you don't see Jesus anymore. Your pain and your panic blind you to his presence, and then the promises don't unfold before your eyes because you are no longer looking in the scriptures. You've ceased to trust what he said. When you look through the lens of pain, everything gets blurred. And it gets so blurred that even though Jesus has promised, "Never will I leave you and never will I forsake you," you can't see him anymore. Remember Mary in the garden by the tomb? Early one morning, it was dark. Why doesn't she see Jesus? Why does she think he's the gardener? Because she's crying so much. And when you're crying and you're in pain, you often cannot see Jesus. So how do they respond when this stranger draws alongside? Well, they get something right here. Verse 17, they stood still, which is what we're going to do over these next 2 days. Be still and know that I'm God. Don't keep running away from what's hurt you, what's confused you. Dare to stand still in your pain. Everything has changed for these disciples, and only in the stillness and the quiet will they hear the gentle wisdom and the life-giving words of Jesus. It's the same for us now in 2013 as it was for them then. It's amazing how the more we are in pain, the busier we get. The more confused we are, the more we fill our lives with noise. When we're hurting, we try and drown out the pain. The minute we get in our cars, we put on the radio. The minute we get in our house, we put on the television. Anything to fill the silence. Because in silence, you will discover when you go for your silent, personal, individual reflection today, that any unresolved pain in your being will rise to the surface. And that's why Jesus calls us to be alone with him, because he's the healer, the redeemer, the restorer. And as long as you keep trying to distance yourself from your broken-hearted pain, then he will be a stranger. If you allow him to draw alongside and speak into your pain, he will become your friend. So they challenged Jesus in verse 18. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have happened here?" Sarcastic, blunt. I wonder if you've ever done that, where somebody kind of tiptoes across your path of disappointment and you just lash out at them. There's some poor unsuspecting shopkeeper or... I know I've done that. So how does Jesus respond? Verse 19, "What things?" he asked them. And when he says to them, "What things?" they say, verse 19, "About Jesus of Nazareth. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed, before God and all the people." Was. Ring that. In other words, it's all over for us. That's the reason for their despair. Verse 20, "The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped." We had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. Had hoped. Past tense. We had a clear plan, and it didn't work out. And actually, their plan was very limited and faulty, because Jesus came to redeem far more than just Israel. He came to redeem the Jews and the Gentiles. And their view of the Messiah is limited and selfish and small, and therefore very easily upset. "What is more, it is the third day since all this took place," they say. But Jesus had promised he would rise on the third day. And they've given up hope when the promise hasn't even been fulfilled. And God is always the answer to the promises of God. He is the answer. They weren't willing to wait. It's the third day, and in their panic and their pain, they forgot the promises of God, and it's not over. They're just going round and around with human wisdom, and they've convinced themselves it is over. Verse 22, "In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb, and they told us, and the angels said he was alive, and some of our companions went, and they found it, and the women, and the angels, and the companions," and they quote absolutely everybody, everybody except Jesus himself. It's so easy to run around getting ideas from everybody and not talk to Jesus. personal ideas, religious ideas, human ideas, and conclude we do not see Jesus. Let Jesus tell you who he is. Jesus tell you who he is. I know for some of you, this trip is frustrating because you have people around you saying Jesus is alive and you say, I can't see him. This is one of these moments, I know what I feel, don't confuse me with the facts moments that these disciples are going through. Jesus has revealed to them their hearts. He's drawn out their story. Their hearts are broken because they think that all they'd hoped for is over. Their hearts are blind. Their eyes are downcast. They look no further than what they can see, and in it all, they can't see Jesus. And he's had enough of their human, limited reasoning, their earthbound conclusions, which look down. And Jesus basically steps in and says, in effect, look up. Regardless of what you see, what has God said and what has God promised? Verse 25, he said to them, how foolish you are. And how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Did not the Messiah have to suffer? See, the moment suffering comes into our lives, many of us think that God has exited our lives as though his presence and suffering are not compatible. It's one or the other. And if you're expectations of God and who God is and what he does are faulty, then when things are tough, you won't recognize or accept that he's present because the circumstances will not match up to your expectations about God. And your expectations about God need to be true. They need to be scriptural. John 16:33, in this world you will have trouble, Jesus said. Expect it, anticipate it. And when it comes, John 14, verse 1, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. Personal suffering, which we all know, is an opportunity to trust God more than you ever have done. Not the moment to cease believing in the God that you thought would not allow suffering in your life. Pain brings this opportunity to realize the truth of all he has promised is bound up in himself and his presence. So how does Jesus change these blind, slow-to-believe hearts into believing, burning hearts? It's so simple. He tells them a story, his story, the real story, not the story that they're caught up in that's all confused, but the real story that's always been in place and always will be in place. It was written since the beginning of time, beginning with Moses and all the prophets. He explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Let Jesus tell you who he is. Let him tell you who he is. They had his story in their hands, but they couldn't see him in it. They couldn't see themselves in it because their circumstances had led them to perceive and therefore believe that all they had hoped for was over. And whenever you think it's all over and you think that all you had hoped for now will never be, with those children who have walked away from home, with that broken marriage, you head home and resume life without Jesus. You just say, well, I'll just keep my head down and keep going. And we need to let Jesus step back in and explain to us what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And then he invites us back into his story, which is still on track, whether we see it or not. Look what happens when they start to sense the truth of what this stranger, up to this point, is revealing to them. As they listen to him explain the scriptures, they want more and more and more. And I don't know how long this Bible study went on. This has to be the most amazing Bible study of all time. Jesus Christ led the Bible study. He led them into the Bible to reveal himself to them. Somebody said the Bible's the only book that when you read it, the author shows up. And Jesus showed up. Verse 28, as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going further. But they urged him strongly, stay with us, for it's nearly evening, the day's almost over. So he went in to stay, underline stay with them. You see, as he invites them back into the story, they invite him into their humble life, their humble village, their humble house. And as Charles and I talk, you'll realize that a house is a representation of yourself, your life, inviting Christ in. And it's when broken hearts longing for healing and blind hearts grasping for understanding cry out to Jesus as the night closes in, as the day is almost over, stay with us through the night. Transformation happens. Have you ever asked Jesus to stay with you through the night? It's in the dark where Jesus moves from being a stranger to being your friend. And these disciples were on the doorstep of what God has for them. But to enter into what God has to them, they have to invite Jesus across the threshold, into their pain and confusion and into their home, into their hearts, into their very lives. Were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures, they say? And their blind eyes that couldn't see through pain and disappointment were opened and they recognized him. Heading number three, they had believing hearts. They replaced their broken blind hearts. And what brought about this change? When did he cease to be a stranger and become a friend? When they invited him in as the night closed in on them. Jesus stepped out of the scriptures and stayed with them and shared a meal with them. My greatest intimacy with Jesus as Christ has come when I've pleaded with him to stay with me through the night. When the day's almost over and the light is fading and my hopes have gone and my dreams are in the dust and I cannot enter the dark night without him. I've looked into scripture because of my own personal experience to find other people who wrestled with God in the night, and there are many of them. Jacob wrestled with God through the night, all night, and he cried out to God, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." Have you ever screamed that to God? "God, this hurts and I hate it and it's dark and I'm here with you all alone, but I will not let you go unless you bless me. Hang on for the blessing. Man, it hurts. But the dawn comes and you might walk with your hip knocked out of joint for the rest of your life, but you will know God. And you'll have met him in the dark and he will no longer be a stranger to you. He will be a friend to you. You'll recognize him, Jesus, in the midst, in the muddle, in the dark. There are many who had conversations with God in the dark. Go into your scriptures and find them where they wrestled with him. And in the dark, God gives you treasures of darkness. He can't give you them in the daylight. He can't give you them anywhere else. He can only give you them as the night closes in. And you say, "Stay with me. Stay with me through the night, Jesus." Moses responded to God's invitation to come up on the mountain and stay. Exodus 20, verse 21. Moses entered the thick darkness where God was. That was a lifeline to me a few years ago. I thought the thick darkness was where God wasn't. But it's where God is. So Moses entered it and he stayed there. David sat up at night watching his flock and he knew this place of intimacy with God and it was forged in the darkness. Psalm 63, verse 6 to 8. "On my bed I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your right hand upholds me." Have you ever actually encountered God in the dark? Have you ever begged him to stay because the day's almost over? The Lord Jesus himself, we are told, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Have you ever thought what a strange sentence that is? The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, gave thanks. Is that what you do on the night you're betrayed? In the dark? You see, Jesus knew all about the dark. He knew what it was to wrestle with God in the dark. He wrestled alone in Gethsemane because all the disciples would rather shut their eyes and go to sleep and pretend the dark wasn't happening. But Jesus knew where this journey was going. "If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. If it's possible, let this cup pass from me." Wrestling with God. "If it's not possible, I'll drink the cup." Have you been on that journey? "I don't want this cup, God. I don't want this life. I don't want this child with disability. I don't want this husband with mental illness. Let this cup pass from me." and you wrestle in the dark to realign your will to God's will, and you end up saying, God, if it's not possible, I will drink the cup. Your will be done. Jesus himself hung on for the blessing. He hung on to keep trusting God. And things didn't get better, they got worse. When the dawn came, the spiritual darkness fell and the moral darkness fell, and the darkness gave way to the light of his betrayer, accompanied by soldiers coming to arrest Jesus. And where's Peter? Peter, who hasn't trusted God in the dark, who hasn't wrestled with God, who has slept instead of praying, swashbuckling out with his sword, lopping off the ear of a soldier. Why? Because he's not prepared in prayer. So he reacts to the situation. Jesus, who has wrestled with God all night, responds to the situation, and he is in total control in that garden. Don't think Jesus is being pushed under at that point against his will. He has surrendered his will to willingly go with those soldiers. He could have just smite them all if he'd chosen to. And Peter's ashamed. He's ashamed he let the dark night pass without encountering God, without surrendering to God, and he runs away. And the next thing we find, he's not following closely, he's following at a distance. And when he's asked if he knows Jesus, he denies him. If we refuse to get close to God in the dark time, it won't be long before we just start drifting away from him and denying him. I don't know if you've encountered God in the dark, if you've had intimate fellowship with him, if you've recognized him in the dark, if you've let him prepare you in the dark for what lies ahead. It's a wonderful place to discover God in the dark, where your hope is restored and you wrestle until you emerge as one who has hung on for the blessing. And the blessing, of course, is God himself. And that night, in the home of these disciples that Jesus had met on that roadside, when he's invited into their home, he takes charge. He is the host, he is not the guest. When he was at the table, verse 30, with them, he took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he began to give it to them. He's in charge, and he took the bread as a visual aid, and it enabled them to recognize him. Here he was, taking the bread, giving thanks, again in the dark, but in their house now, in their lives. And this is the Jesus we know, I'm sure they thought. This is the Jesus who eats with us, kneels and washes our feet, breaks the bread and tells us its body, gives the wine and tells us it's his blood. The life's in the blood. We now see it's not about death. He's alive. And they recognize him in life where they had lost him in death. And now all they want to do is run and tell their friends and family, who they know are also confused and are also waiting in the dark, which is probably true of a lot of your friends and family. They're in the dark. They're disillusioned in the dark. Verse 33, we read, they got up. They returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, it's true. The Lord is risen and he's appeared to Simon. And then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. See, now they have a story to tell. And it's a personally encountering God in the dark story. Have you got one of those? A personally encountering God in the dark story? I have to say, most of what I speak in the light has come out of what God's told me in the darkness. And it seems strange that we read, then their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight, verse 31. He's here. They've recognized him. Why does he go when they've pleaded with him to stay with us through the night? Well, tucked away is that little word, stay. I hope you circle it. In that word is the wonderful truth that Jesus is alive. In the Old Testament, God never came to stay. He came and he went. He visited individuals. He invited them into his story. He equipped them by his spirit. A specific person for a specific time, for a specific purpose, and then he withdrew. He was a God afar. He was a God to be feared. He was a God you brought sacrifices to. Blood was shed. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. And now Jesus has brought forgiveness. Jesus has shed his blood. And this little incident shows us a couple moving from the Old Testament God to the New Testament, Jesus Christ. Their relationship previously was about a God they feared. They were forbidden to see God. No one can look on God, we're told. There's that wonderful moment when he passes by Moses and he allows him to see his back and he tells him who he is. He's a God of long-suffering and patience. But they couldn't go near the mountain. They couldn't touch. They couldn't be close. But Jesus touched people. People touched Jesus. Children clambered all over him. In the Old Testament, people sacrificed over and over again, and it was never enough. And the day came, it's recorded in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 5 to 7, Jesus looked out of heaven and he said, I'm coming down. I'm coming to be the sacrifice. Verse 5, therefore when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice an offering you did not desire, a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings you were not pleased. And then I said, here I am. It's written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, my God. Jesus offered to come and God let him go. I used to think when I read that verse, God so loved the world, he sent his only begotten son. Well, that's all very fine for God. He sits in heaven and he says to Jesus, on you go. You go and sort them all out. And I thought that wasn't fair. And then I understood. Jesus said, I'm the sacrifice. I'll go. And God so loved the world, he sent his son. And Jesus came, and God in Christ moved in, not to just visit and disappear. He moved in to stay. He made the world. He visited the world. He met with people. Now he came to live. He came to stay. Leviticus 26, verses 11 to 12, he promised, I will put my dwelling place among you. I will walk among you and be your God. When Jesus walks among, he's come to stay, and even when you can't see him and when he disappears from your sight in the night, he has come to stay. And the shift from him visiting to remaining all takes place at his baptism. And if you blink, you miss it. It's in a little verse, John chapter 1, verse 32 to 34. I'm going to repeat a word in this, and I want you to pick up on it. Then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen Son. And the repeated word is, remain. Jesus has come to stay. The Father speaks, the Son hears, the Spirit hovers. In this moment we have the Godhead together, and Jesus has come to stay. So once their eyes have been opened and they've recognized him, he can disappear from their sight because he's come to stay and he'll be back again in his new resurrection body until this moment at Pentecost where he comes forever to abide in us by his Holy Spirit. He will remain. Abide in me, Jesus promised, and I will abide in you. He has come to stay. He's the final sacrifice. So although now at this point they are left, they are not bereft as they were before. And now they have, heading for, burning hearts. When did their broken hearts start burning? When he opened up the scriptures. Someone has said, the new is in the old concealed. The old is in the new revealed. And Jesus reveals the old in himself. What was concealed in Moses and all the prophets concerning Jesus? What turns words on a page to words of life? Why, maybe, is Jesus still hidden to you? Where do you think you will find Jesus? John 5:39, Jesus rebuked the Pharisees. You study the scriptures. In fact, you study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very scriptures that testify about me, but you refuse to come to me. Is your Bible alive? Is it a place you meet with God? Is it your very lifeline? I wonder how many of you have an intimate, personal relationship with God. Saying to somebody yesterday, when I became a Christian, the age of 19, I was told by many zealous Christians that Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. But I soon discovered that 90% of the people who said those words didn't actually have the relationship that they told me it was. They just told me it's a relationship. They didn't have one. They just said it was one. How about you? How's your relationship going with Jesus? Is it the most important relationship in your life? Is it the non-negotiable in your life? Or do you just kind of ditch it? Do you give up your times of reading and meeting and praying and pleading with God and start going around in circles backwards and forwards and getting more and more confused? Their broken, blind hearts have become believing hearts. He gives them bread, they recognize him. They become burning hearts when he opens up the scriptures concerning himself. Beginning with Moses and all the prophets. But may you have this same experience this morning as you go off alone. May you experience intimate fellowship with Jesus Christ. Perhaps the night's closing in for you. The sun's shining very brightly here for all of us today, but perhaps in your heart, it's a very dark place in there because you have a broken heart. See, your personal story might have brought you to Israel very confused and very bemused, and you might have forgotten to remember the promises. It's our prayer that God will draw you back into his story and remind you that all that's true of him can be true for you again. When all that you had hoped for in your marriage, in your home, on your street, in your church, in your place of work, is still possible. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your presence here this morning. We thank you for this amazing little cameo of two despondent, discouraged disciples heading home thinking it's all over. Thank you that you are the good shepherd, you are the seeker, you are the bread of life who comes to find the hungry, you're the living water who comes to find the thirsty. God, we are hungry, we are thirsty. Some of us are extremely confused, and some of us feel the night is closing in. We thank you that you are present with us, you love us, you promised to stay, you called us to abide. Help us to learn, even in this hour, to abide in you as you abide in us. Thank you for your love. Thank you that the darkness is not a place to fear, but a place where we can encounter you. Thank you that scripture says, even the darkness will not be dark to you. I pray you would bring light into our dark places today as we quietly head off to sit alone with you. And we pray in Jesus' wonderful risen name. Amen.
Know someone who would benefit from this message?
Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca.
And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Join Charles next week for another message from the Holy Land series, The Place of God's Throne.
Rise to thee. love and purity. Lift your voices. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, all thy work shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea.